Does Peter call Jesus God in 2 Peter 1:1? When we examine this verse from a grammatical standpoint, it is evident that he does. Let's look at the verse. Simeon Peter, a servant and apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who have obtained a faith of equal standing with ours by the righteousness of our God and Savior Jesus Christ. In English, the phrase, our God and Savior Jesus Christ, is ambiguous and could be read in two different ways. One option is to take this verse as referring to one person, that is, Jesus, our God and Savior Jesus Christ. Another option is to take this verse as referring to two persons, God and Jesus, our God and the Savior Jesus Christ. However, looking at this verse in Greek clears up the ambiguity. Here is the phrase in Greek. The phrase uses the following construction, article, noun 1, and noun 2. Notice that a single article, the, governs the two nouns, God and Savior, and these nouns are connected by and. According to the Granville-Sharp rule, this construction indicates that both terms, God and Savior, have the same referent, Jesus Christ. Here is James White's simple explanation of the Granville-Sharp rule. Basically, the rule states that when you have two nouns which are not proper names, such as Cephas or Paul, or Timothy, which are describing a person and are connected by the word and the first noun has the article while the second does not, both nouns are referring to the same person. In 2 Peter 1:1, since God has the article and is followed by and, which is then followed by Savior without the article, both nouns apply to Jesus Christ. This rule can be observed numerous times in the New Testament and other Greek writings. In fact, we see the same construction elsewhere in the epistle of 2 Peter itself. Here are three other examples where this construction occurs. In each of these examples, both nouns, Lord and Savior, refer to Jesus Christ. The constructions in 2 Peter 1:1 and 3:18 are identical to 1:1, the only difference being Lord instead of God. Nobody disputes that both nouns refer to Jesus in 1:11 and 3:18, so why would we doubt that both nouns refer to Jesus in the parallel construction found in 1:1? From a strictly grammatical standpoint, we shouldn't. Indeed, if Peter wanted to clearly distinguish between God and Jesus in 2 Peter 1:1, he could have easily done so by using a different grammatical construction, like the one he uses in the very next verse. But he doesn't. Instead, he uses a construction identical to the other grammatical constructions in his letter, where the phrase refers to a single person, Jesus, as Richard Bauckham writes. Elsewhere in the letter, the writer uses the similarly constructed phrase, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, where there is no doubt that the whole phrase refers to Jesus Christ. When, however, this writer wishes to distinguish the two persons in 1:2, the construction is different, of God and Jesus our Lord. Thus, given the grammatical structure of the verse, it is evident that Peter calls Jesus God in 2 Peter 1:1. Answering objections. While the text is clear-cut grammatically, some might object to the interpretation that God is applied to Jesus in 2 Peter 1:1 on the basis that 2 Peter 1:2 distinguishes between God and Jesus our Lord. However, this objection assumes that Jesus cannot be identified as God and also be distinct from God. Several New Testament passages show that this assumption is unwarranted. For instance, in the same verse, John 1:1 explicitly identifies the Word as God and yet also distinct from God. This word is the same word who takes on flesh as the man Jesus in John 1:14. Additionally, John 1:18 identifies Jesus as the only God who is at the Father's side, clearly identifying Jesus as God and yet distinct from the Father who is God. John 20 identifies Jesus as God in verse 18 and yet distinct from God in verses 17 and 31. Finally, Hebrews 1:8 through 9 once again identifies the Son as God and yet also distinct from God. Given these other New Testament examples of Jesus being identified as God while also being distinct from God, we have no reason to assume that the same thing couldn't have occurred in 2 Peter 1:1 through 2. These statements affirming Jesus as God and distinct from God occur in tandem elsewhere in the New Testament. So 2 Peter 1:1 through 2 is not an unusual case. Another objection to Jesus's identity as God in 2 Peter 1:1 is simply that Jesus is rarely identified as God. So it seems unlikely that he would be so identified here, but this objection is ad hoc. It is an attempt to dismiss a clear reference to Jesus being God because it doesn't happen often. But instead of ruling out what the grammar indicates at the outset, we should interpret the text for what it plainly says. Moreover, rarely does not mean never, and as we've already seen, Jesus is called God in several New Testament passages. Christian writings from the early 2nd century also demonstrate that Jesus being called God was not uncommon by that time. Bauckham lists several sources. Early extra-canonical Christian literature shows that by the beginning of the 2nd century, the title was not uncommon. Thus, there is no improbability in 2 Peter's use of God for Jesus, nor does the usage require a 2nd century date for the letter. In conclusion, in 2 Peter 1:1, Jesus is called God and Savior. This fact is evident grammatically per the Granville-Sharp rule. Parallel constructions in Peter's epistle consistently demonstrate the validity of the interpretation in 1:1 that Peter applies both nouns God and Savior to Jesus. Objections to this grammatical fact are insufficient to overrule what the grammar clearly indicates. That God and Jesus are distinguished in 1:2 does not preclude that 1:1 identifies Jesus as God. Other New Testament passages affirm Jesus as God and distinct from God, so 2 Peter 1:1-2 is not unusual. Moreover, ruling out the idea that Jesus is identified as God in 2 Peter 1:1 because of the rarity of such identification is ad hoc. We should take the text for what it says. Also, rarely does not mean never. Peter's explicit affirmation of Jesus as God is what we would expect from someone concluding his epistle with a doxology to Jesus in language matching biblical doxologies to Yahweh. Peter says, quote, "But grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be the glory both now and to the day of eternity. Amen." The parallel statements "our God and Savior Jesus Christ" and "our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ" frame Peter's epistle, echoing Thomas's declaration that Jesus is indeed Lord and God. Hey everyone, thank you so much for watching this video. I hope you liked it. If you did like it, consider giving it a thumbs up and sharing your thoughts in the comments below. Also, if you want to see more content like this, I want to invite you to subscribe to my channel. You can also hit that little bell so that you'll be notified when new videos like this are released. I'll see you next time. Blessings and shalom. Just a heads up that my new book on the Sabbath was recently released. It's called Remember the Sabbath, What the New Testament Says About Sabbath Observance for Christians. If you've ever wondered about the Sabbath and whether or not it applies to Christians, I wrote this book for you. I argue from the New Testament that Christians should remember the Sabbath. I also answer all the common objections from those who say that the Sabbath was done away with or changed in the New Testament. I even have a chapter answering your frequently asked questions about the Sabbath. Look at how much this person loves her copy of Remember the Sabbath. This could be you. Here's Spider-Man taking a break, a Sabbath rest, if you will, to hang on the side of a building and read my book. Resting gives him the energy he needs to apprehend criminals and save the day. Get your copy of Remember the Sabbath at sabbathbook.com and you will be as cool as Spider-Man.